Russian meddling is so much bigger than the 2016 campaign.
Agents of a hostile foreign power reached into the United States using our own social media platforms.
They established social media pages and groups to communicate with unwitting Americans.
They're using these platforms to try to divide us.
We're at a point where people don't trust anything.
Frankly, the United States is under attack.
What most people don't realize is the Russians didn't just meddle in the election of Donald Trump, they targeted almost every major American social movement.
The defendants and their co-conspirators pretended to be grassroots activists. According to the indictment, the Americans did not know that they were communicating with Russians.
The Russians were really good at this. After the election, it took months for Congress, the US government, independent researchers, and investigative journalists to figure out what really had just gone on. And we're still learning more even today. One clear target, racial tensions. CNN uncovered how one Russian campaign played out in real time, unbeknownst to those who were really involved. It was July 2016. Philando Castile had just been shot by police in Minnesota, and his girlfriend, Diamond Reynolds, began streaming live on Facebook.
Stay with me.
The last moments of Castile's life would be seen by millions of people around the world.
The video went around on Facebook. It was viral like crazy.
Oh my God, please don't tell me he's dead. Please don't tell me my boyfriend just went like that.
It was pretty unreal to watch that almost in real time.
We began to receive text messages, Facebook messages, all at the same time. It was like everyone's phone started going off. A couple people said, we're gonna go down to the governor's mansion.
Philando! Philando!
Activists on the ground decided the mansion would be the main site of their protest. But at the same time, a mysterious group called Don't Shoot began organizing a different protest outside the police department where the officer who had shot Castile worked.
Where did this organization come from? We're used to actually being reached out to help bring people to the protests. And this was something that literally just came out of the blue. The 4th Precinct was in Minneapolis, North Minneapolis, and the governor's mansion is in St. Paul, Minnesota. Two completely different areas with different demographics.
Being involved here for the last number of years, I know that there is no organization called Don't Shoot, and so I knew that something was off. I just poked around a little bit, looked at their page, saw that it had thousands of likes. Then I messaged their page. I said, who are you involved with? Who do you have on the ground that's working on setting this up? I know individuals in all of these organizations. None of them had heard of this group, none of them had heard of this event, and none of them were involved in planning this event.
We need to reach out to these people to make sure they know what they're doing and they don't put people in danger.
Any number of things could happen when thousands of people show up with mixed emotions during the peak of an anti-police brutality movement.
Our solution was to kind of take over the event and have our own marshals and have our own leaders.
We ended up occupying space in front of the police department and no one got hurt. That was our top priority.
But this was much deeper than just a rogue protest.
We got an anonymous tip forwarded to us that stated that their website was registered to some strip mall in Illinois.
But no one at the mall knew about the website. It was a fake address, it was a fake page, it was a fake website. In reality, Don't Shoot was being run from more than 4,000 miles away in St. Petersburg, Russia.
CNN has now learned Don't Shoot Us wasn't local nor national. It was Russian.
The troll group was the Internet Research Agency. It had ties to the Kremlin, a budget in the millions, and a network of thousands of fake American social media accounts. And it only took them a few hours to begin posting about the shooting of Philando Castile.
Tell your friends and families about our protest.
Notice anything strange about it? This page was actually run from St. Petersburg in Russia.
I don't like that at all. Because for one thing, you're using my son's face. You understand what I'm saying? This is my son. God gave him to me. Nobody had the right to take him from me. And then to take such a sad situation and exploit it, you know, no. And for them to use my baby, no, uh-uh.
The world knows Philando Castile's name because of Facebook. It's where his girlfriend began to stream live after he was shot. It's where his family and friends turned to organize after he died. But it's also where the Russian troll group would seek to exploit the tragedy.
It makes sense that they would want to see America have these like really deep, intense struggles.
Disruption is really easy because the tools of technology allow you to reach hundreds of millions of people at an incredibly low cost.
Apart from the occasional typo, the troll group's posts on Facebook, Instagram, YouTube, Tumblr, and Twitter were pretty convincing. But there were some signs that these groups weren't quite what they seemed. The fake Russian page was called Don't Shoot, named after an earlier Black Lives Matter slogan.
Don't shoot!
When Mike Brown was first killed, a lot of people were saying, hands up, don't shoot. People weren't chanting, hands up, don't shoot anymore at that point.
In one instance, we found Cyrillic characters, a Russian word embedded in the metadata of a document that Don't Shoot had distributed. Cyber experts told us that this was an indication that the computer where the document was created was running the Russian language. On other posts, they kept using the wrong type of punctuation mark, like here, where they use a backwards apostrophe. It turns out a lot of Russian keyboards don't have the standard apostrophe that's used in the English language. But overall, the Russians were really good at doing this. According to US investigators, staff at the Internet Research Agency would have regular check-ins with their managers to see if their posts looked and sounded American enough. There are many fake social media accounts still out there today that we suspect are Russian. This account was set up in September 2016 under the alias Robert Jameson. But the picture isn't of a guy called Robert Jameson. It's of some guy who lives in the United States that knew nothing about this account until CNN told him about it. After we told him about the account, he reported it to Facebook and it got taken down.
You're not allowed to have a fake account on Facebook, especially large networks of fake accounts like the Russians have.
Can you guarantee that any of those images that can be attributed or associated with the Russian company, Internet Research Agency, have been purged from your platform?
Senator, no, I can't guarantee that, because this is an ongoing arms race.
These companies have a responsibility to really start to look into what's happening on their websites and take more of a role in making sure that their social media site isn't the cause for a coup or a civil war or World War III.
Even if you liked the outcome in 2016, what you have to know is that in 2018, anybody can do this. Now that the Russians have provided a playbook, we have to expect that the Chinese, the North Koreans, the Iranians, and everybody else who doesn't like us, which these days is a lot of people, is going to do that. We now have technologies that, if you have 20 minutes of voice, can produce things that sound like anyone.
I kiss my dogs and my wife.
So how about we mess with who he actually kissed? Type the word Jordan. And here we go.
And I kiss Jordan and my dogs.
It's going to be very straightforward to create audio that sounds completely authentic, that is completely inauthentic. And that is, in my mind, terrifying.
This altered video of US presidents old and new, published by university researchers, shows how easily video can be manipulated, even in real time. These technologies will become more sophisticated, more believable, and easier to produce. In 2016, it was fake social media accounts and fake posts. In 2020, it could be fake video and fake audio. What happens when we can no longer tell what videos are real and what videos are fake? How will that change the perception of our next national tragedy?
I believe we would be in a much better place if social media had never happened.
We had no idea when they came out that they could be used to manipulate politics or public opinions. We thought there was just another way to share photos and connect with people from high school.
We expect Russia to continue using propaganda, social media, false flag personas, sympathetic spokesman, and other means to to influence, to try to build on its wide range of operations and exacerbate social and political fissures in the United States.
It's really hard to stop, and I think stopping it is not the most likely case. I think the thing we can do as citizens is make sure that we're well prepared, be more suspicious of things that confirm our biases.
The Russians fooled a lot of us in 2016. Clearly, as a society, we need to be more wary of what we see online and determine post by post what's real and what's fake.